Good morning, students. Today I will demonstrate creating event handlers and registering the event handler to an HTML element in an HTML page, and also a brief introduction to CSS, which I already studied in the previous semesters. So CSS part is a very brief introduction, just enough for our execution of our graded exercises in web programming lab. See, now I'll go for web page editing. See, this is the web page factorial.html. it contains not so much content here. Here is just one header line, that is factorial, and here it is body tag. And observe that there is one script tag, a pair of script tag within the head section of the body. And now I'll open this file in a browser. I'll double click this file. Observe that I'm getting the browser window display for the web page factorial.html. there is just one line, that is factorial, that is in the code. I'll just edit the file factorial demonstration. I will save the code. Come to the browser, just refresh it. See, now code is executed, and that is updated. Web page is updated. Now here I will insert one button by using input tag. So I'll specify the type of the input element here is button value. Click here and I will close the tag according to the XHTML standard, that is forward slash then end bracket. I will update it, store it, and refresh it. Observe that one button appeared, and for this button, when I click on this button, nothing happened in the web page. It is quite obvious because here is event is created. When I click on the button, I will bring the mouse pointer above this one, and when I click the button, that is when I press the left button, you can see that the state of the button is slightly modified. It may look different behavior in different browser, but there is my slight changes in the behavior. So event is generated, that means it notifies that event is generated, that is click event, but nothing is happened in the browser or any other changes. The reason is the code we have not given nothing. So nothing is given any information within the script tag. So I will give the code within the script tag, that is function keyword, that is a JavaScript keyword, and I will type factorial as the function name, and just one empty body, no other statement is given, just only the function name and empty body. And I will register this code with the element. The element is here is input type input, and for that I will register the code with the onClick event attribute. OnClick event attribute. So I will specify the name of the function as a string. So here is name of the function, here is factorial and semicolon. Since this code follows the JavaScript syntax that is derived from Java, so semicolon is required. I will stop, save this. Once again I will display the program, so same page, refresh the code and click here. When I click on the click here button, again event is generated and event handler is invoked. That means when I click on the button, it calls the factorial function that is provided within the script tag. But since the function itself is blank, that means it is empty, the function body is empty, so no changes seen in the web page. Now the logic of the factorial function you already know. You have to input an integer. By using a loop we will find the factorial value by multiplying it to 1 to n, and the result is returned to the calling point. So here is, I will declare a variable num. Num is a variable where our input value is stored, equals, and just like in C or Java we have to use a function to provide the input to variable. I will use the JavaScript function prompt. Enter an integer is the prompt string and semicolon. Save the code and refresh it. Now when I click on this click here button, you can see I will get one prompt window. Here is the script prompt, enter an integer, and within the text box or input box there is undefined information there. That means here is a default value is given. I will give 5, just type 5 and click on OK button. When I click on the OK button, nothing is happened, but it demonstrates that when I press the button, it prompts one user window, that is user prompt window, where I can give some information with the text box and click OK. That is stored in the browser. That's stored in the variable. So now, as the given information can be of anything, so by default the prompt returns the given information in string format. So I have to pass that information to int by using the JavaScript parseInt function. ParseInt, you already know, we have used parseInt function in Java, that is string.parseInt, integer.parseInt, float.parseFloat, so like this. So if our information entered by using prompt function is string, then it parses it into integer and stores in the num. Now go for next codes, variable num. Fact equals 1 to store the factorial value, and variable I, that's a counter. Then the loop you already know, I equals 1, I less than or equal to num, I plus plus, fact star equals, that is fact equals fact star I. See, at this instance, that means after the execution of the for loop, the factorial is stored in the fact variable. I have to display that variable by using alert method. Here I will use the string concatenation method, factorial of plus. It is string concatenation method type used in Java. Factorial of, this is the input num. Again is equals and fact. So here it ends our JavaScript function. See, here is, this is the code. Using prompt method, I am providing the input. Input value is stored in num. Fact is initialized to 1. Using a loop, I am calculating the factorial value. And one more thing, I will give a default value, another argument, it is optional part. So prompt has two parameters. First is the prompt string and second is the default input. If not specified, then 0 will be taken as the input. Since the factorial of the 0 is 1, so no problem. So we can go for 0 or 1, but don't give any other values. See, here is, I will refresh the page as the code has been updated. Now we'll run the program. Factorial of given number. Observe that enter an integer that is given in the code and 0. Earlier it was undefined, now it is 0. If I click OK, I'm not providing any value. So if I click OK, then the code will find the factorial value for the variable 0. Click OK. So after the variable factorial calculation, alert window displays the result. So click OK. Observe that factorial of 0 is 1. I will click it once again. This time I will give the value 5. Click OK. Factorial of 5 is 20. So you may give any other different values, but don't give too much bigger values because this code has some limitation. So this code will work only for small range of values. Observe here, factorial of 10 is 3628800. So it's somewhat bigger value. So this code is not 100% perfect program because we have not used any validation concept in this program. So if we give the wrong information, so we will get some wrong input. So we will not get any error warnings or any other informations. So it is just a plain implementation of factorial program. Not any other validation rules are used. It's just for demonstration. So I stored it. So refreshed it. When I click on the button, I will get one user prompt. There you type the value and click OK. The code calculates the value and alert method will use to display the information. See, factorial of 12 is some bigger number here. Click OK. So this is one small demonstration for event handler creation using JavaScript and storing it as a function and assigning it to event attribute of the element. And event attribute, you must be very careful. If you used on click, then it will be used only with the click event, not any other events. Okay, now you go for a small introduction for CSS. Cascaded style sheet, it's a style sheet describing language used to design the presentation of a web page. So it is released initially as the first version in 1996. Next updated version CSS 2 is in 1998. CSS 3 was released in 1999 and CSS 4 released in 2007. So these are the list of major releases. Minor releases are many. So CSS 4 first version, that is first draft, is released in 2007. Later there are many enhancements are introduced. So we'll say CSS 4 first enhancement release is done in released in 2007. We have to insert the CSS code, and there are basically three methods. One is inline, next one is internal, another one is last one is external. So inline codes are inserted within the tag code itself. So within the code it is inserted, and internal here is those style rules are stored in one place within the document, and here is it will be called as internal. If the style rules are very complex and too big or must be shared among multiple web documents, then those style rules are stored separately in the web page, as in the CSS file, and linked it with the web documents. Those are called as here is external CSS. Usually in the regular practice, external CSS are used because style rules has to be shared with the multiple documents. Any company's website contains hundreds or thousands of HTML pages, and all are must follow the same style rule. So external CSS is the actual method is in practice. Now we'll go for some simple demonstration. Observe that this is one simple document contains some paragraph lines. If I open this file in the browser window, I will get some familiar display that is like this. You can see, let's close other windows. See, this is the browser window, and according to the tag I will get some display within the browser window. Now I will insert one code here. For paragraph tag I will give one inline style, that is within the tag I will type the keyword style, and for that I will assign the style rule. For example, color of the text should be red. Observe that those attributes are in key value pairs, where color is the key and red is the value, separated by, that is, colon symbol. And every key value pair, that is attribute name and attribute value, are separated by terminated by semicolon. So color colon red semicolon. I will save this. Now I will come to the browser window, refresh this. Observe that the browser window shows only the first paragraph line in red color. Remaining are is in the their default appearance. That means, for if the elements are not specified with any style rules, then the browser will apply the default rules for all the elements. Observe that the first paragraph is in red color. Likewise, I will provide one more style equals color. I will give the purple. Let us check how it will displays. Come to the browser. I will refresh it. We can see the color is changing, different color. The color is changed, so it's not so visible. Okay, I will change it to blue color. Refresh the page. Okay, now it is color is changed to blue color. Observe that only the paragraph having inline styles are updated here. No other paragraphs are modified. So out of the 6 paragraphs, only 2 are having the inline styles, and remaining of the paragraphs are here is in default style. So this is for style rule providing in inline style. So now we'll go for the next one, that is internal style. Here instead of providing different tag separately for the elements, I will store them in a head section within the style tag. Within the style tag, I will specify the element name P. This is the element name P, and for that I will define the style rule like this. See, you have to specify the style tag within the head section of the page, and here specify the name of the tag, and within the pair of brackets you give the style rule. For example, color colon red. I will update for refresh the file. Observe that all the P tags are applied with the style rule, that is text color red. Text color here is red. So this is for specifying a rule by using selectors, that is ID selectors. Element selector. It's not ID, element selector. So element is specified by P tag. So paragraph element is applied with the style rule. So I will just update the code P. And color is red, and I will specify the text align as center. Now the paragraphs are aligned center. I will refresh the page. Observe that the page will be get refreshed. Now all are in center aligned step. See, now if I change the red color to color red to green, I will refresh the web page, refresh it. Now the text colors are in green color. So this is for element tag. Now I will apply for different method, that is ID selector. So these are called here is selector name, that is P selector. If I use HTML tag name here, then it is called as element selector. Now we'll go for next method, that is ID selector. So instead of providing a rule for all the tags, I will go for a name, that is ID name. Within the style tag, that ID name is begins with the hash symbol, and here I will provide text align center semicolon and color red. And likewise, I can go for any other ID series. I will give it is paragraph 3. And these style rules are applied only to the element having this ID. So, for example, for the first paragraph, I will provide the ID as para 1. See that for para 1 ID, I specified alignment of text as in the center, and the text color here is red. For para 3, text align is right and color here is red. Observe that I given the ID for the one paragraph here is para 1. This is para 1, and to specify this para in style, I have to start it with hash symbol. So within body those hash is not used. Now I will go for the demonstration of the page. I will double refresh it. Observe that the para 1 ID is in red color and text is aligned to center of the browser window. If I change the width of the browser, it updated its position such that it's always in the center of the web browser window. And for para 3, no changes here. The reason is that for para 3 or whatever the para you may choose here, it's not provided with the ID para 3. So if I give any other paragraph with this ID para 3. See now, para 3 is taken as ID for a particular paragraph. It need not be third one, you can give it to any, but the care should be taken that the para name, sorry, ID name must be unique. It need not be shared with the more than one elements. Now I will refresh it. See now, the paragraph with the ID para 3 is right aligned. It is right aligned and color is in red color. I will change the color here. Instead of this, I will make it as blue color. Save the code. The HTML file is saved and refresh it. So this is for ID style rules. So ID selector is used in CSS. Now I will go for the next one, that is class rule. In class rule, more than one element can have the similar style rule. It need not be same tag, but it can be different also. So that class rule is given similar to ID rule. Only thing is that the class name is starts with a dot. For example, here is my style. I will give it is my style. Observe that name of the class begins with a dot, but while specifying this name of the class in a HTML paragraph tag, that dot is not used. Series text align center and color is blue. And I will give this class to the paragraph like this by using the keyword class and my style. Observe that for the paragraph I provided the class rule like this. That means this paragraph will follow the style rule of my style, where in the within the style tag the class name begins with a dot, but in paragraph or in any HTML element while assigning this class rule, that dot is not used. And the advantage of class rule is that irrespective of the type of the element, I can apply this rule, that is it can be shared by more than one element, whereas in the ID tag I can have such type of facility because it my ID must be unique. Observe that for header one also I have assigned with the same class. I will apply the, saved it. Now I will refresh the web page. Observe that first paragraph, fourth paragraph and the last header line are having the same style rule. So style rule is shared with different type of element. That is, in this case it is paragraph tag and also header one tag. So paragraph element, P element and H1 element also having the, they are following the same class rule. So the advantage of class is that different type of elements can have the same styles. Now the last one for this one. I will remove these class rules. I will just demonstrate the grouping of elements. See, this is header 2. I'm just copy see now if I want to apply the same style rule for more than one element, then I can group them like this. Similar to element selector, here is they are grouped together, that is separated by comma here. That is, here it is paragraph and header 1. So that means paragraph tag and header 1 tag have same effect, and H2 is not specified, that is header 2, so it will not have any style rule. That so browser will display it in default style. So I'll refresh the page. Observe that paragraph, header are in the style rule accordingly, whatever specified is in the style tag. And H2 line is not displayed with any specific style rule. So it's showing with the default style. Later we are given paragraph line, again it is applied. So this is the effect of grouping of element for style rule. Okay students, here it completes today's session. So these are the information, very essential information required while solving the graded exercises specified for our subject web programming lab. Thank you.